So we're down to the final two classes. Today's and Thursday's lecture will be very, very different. And they kind of are both meant to wrap up everything we've done. So over the last, well, since the midterm, we've really been focusing on why we do what we do to food. So why do we have the chemistry that we use? Why do we do the processing that we do? So now what we're going to do is we're going to take a step back and kind of go between where we started with how the human body interacts with food, and then we went to how do we structure foods, and now we're going to kind of go back and take a critical look at diet and the idea of diet. So the concept of food being an integral part of our makeup has been known for a very, very long time. And in the most earliest thought, with let food be your medicine and medicine your food, really tries to illustrate the importance of eating a whole, well-balanced diet. And that's the premise of the Canadian Food Guide. So if anyone's not familiar with the Canadian Food Guide, it's a document that really is a common sense document. It focuses on, first and foremost, preventing nutritional deficiencies. And it prevents nutritional deficiencies by trying to eat a balanced, well-rounded diet. The other thing it does is it tries to focus on eating enough calories to maintain a healthy weight and to prevent obesity. And now we're moving into this whole idea that nutrition can be used to optimize our health and delay the onset of degenerative diseases. So when we talk about the Canadian Food Guide, depending if you're male or female and depending on age, changes the amount of food we eat. It doesn't really change the distribution of the food groups, but typically we're supposed to eat diets enriched in vegetables and fruit, high in grains, low in milk alternatives, and low in meat and processed meat. Now, what is the requirement for the food guide to work? The underlying premise that is so important is the idea of portion control. And this is probably what Canadians and North Americans have the largest challenge with. So we've already talked about the behavioral drive to eat and how it's influenced by mood, how it's influenced by environment, how it's influenced by plate size, the bottomless bowl experiments we've talked about, and all of these things have an underlying effect that determine how much food we consume. So even though we know what an appropriate balance between the macronutrients are, the idea that we follow the food guide is a little bit challenging. So the take-home message when you go and you read this document, fruits and vegetables, increase fiber, eliminate trans fats, reduce saturated fats, reduce total fat, include polyunsaturated, reduce simple sugars, increase calcium, reduce energy intake, drink water, and get a good balance of micronutrients. All of these things we've talked about throughout this course. We've talked about the challenges to implementing these into processed foods, and obviously we can see why processing foods doesn't necessarily fit well with the Canadian Food Guide. So when we talk about refining, when we refine a cereal grain, or when we refine cereal, what are we eliminating in that process? We're removing the bran layer, which contains mainly the fiber. So processing foods reduces drastically the amount of fiber we consume. What else does it do? It reduces the micronutrients that are present. So it reduces the density of the micronutrients, which are essential for health. We typically, in processed foods, elevate the total amount of sugars as well as refined fats. So we've seen drastic increase in the amount of uptake of both total fats, saturated fats, and up until this year, trans fats. Now we fix trans fats. So how can we develop a processed food industry that takes into account the needs of the average consumer? It becomes very, very difficult to do, right? When we talk about increasing the amount of polyunsaturated fats, it becomes difficult because we require those crystals to impart that elastic nature of butter and lard. So when we take out saturated fat, what do we replace it with? Do we replace it with just simply adding more unsaturated oil and making that sensory appeal of that product change? Or do we add carbohydrates and proteins, of which we showed last day that there's not that much of a biological benefit to replacing saturated fats with carbohydrates? So the idea of eating a healthy diet really relies on the consumer not eating large amounts of processed or ultra-processed foods, avoiding boxed, frozen foods, eating the perimeter of the grocery store, right? So you've produce, your dairy, your meats and alternatives, they're all located on the outside of that grocery store. So when we talk about eating a diet that's really elevated in processed foods, what people are doing is making a conscious decision to eat high saturates, high salt, high calories, specifically from refined sugars and refined fats and oils, and this predisposes people to risks of cardiovascular disease, so arterial sclerosis, diabetes, hypertension. And all of this has consequences, and this is going to have huge social implications in the next 100 years. As our population begins to age and our obesity rates tend to climb, the cost to maintaining these chronic diseases is going to put a burden on the healthcare system. And as more people become aged in that demographic where we're relying on or have contracted a diet-related disease, we are going to have a huge financial burden that's going to be on our healthcare system, which is already strained. So when we talk about the Canadian Food Guide portion control, we know that environmental cues determine how much food we eat, but it goes far beyond that. Even as students, you are exposed to an environment in which your food comes from, right? So everyone here that lives on campus or close to campus, your food choice is determined based on availability. So if you live on campus, your food environment is Guelph, the university, right? So it's the cafeterias that you consume from. So the idea to have healthy choices within this environment is extremely important. And this brings us to a whole concept when we talk about food security, which Evan Fraser talked about, when we talk about food deserts and food swamps. The idea of this is that the marketplace is either devoid of healthy food options or is oversaturated with unhealthy food options. So a food swamp means that there's grocery stores. There are places like Zehrs, Loblaws, Whole Foods. They exist. But there are so many convenience stores and fast food restaurants that the choice doesn't become as apparent, meaning you will make more often the choice to go to a negative food establishment, a McDonald's, a Burger King, a Wendy's, a Harvey's, a Swiss Chalet, a Kentucky Fried Chicken, as opposed to your grocery store. Food deserts, on the other hand, are devoid of healthy food options. And this becomes extremely important when we talk about large cities, Saskatoon, Toronto, Montreal, wherever you are. And these are demographics or areas that are devoid of grocery stores, devoid of farmers market, and have a high concentration of fast food and convenience stores. Now, what is so sad about this is that 23.5 million people in North America live in urban neighborhoods and rural towns that have limited access to affordable food options. Meaning, where you live is saturated with things like convenience stores. So when you go in to make your food choice there, you can buy an apple for $1.50, or you can buy a frozen dinner for $2.99. So where does that choice lie? It's much more simple and much easier, especially when you have children, to fill that fast food as opposed to that healthy food choice. This is the one that shocks me. 21 million households don't have access to a car and don't live within a mile of a grocery store. So for you, how many of you do your own grocery shopping at places like Ultramart, No Frills, wherever? So about half of you. How many of you are shopping for more than one person? A few. Do you guys have access to cars? The people that have more than one person? No? Yes? Yes? If you try to grocery shop for more than one person, without a car, relying on either public transportation or just walking or bicycling, it becomes very, very challenging to do. Buying whole milk. Again, you make conscious decisions based on how you're going to transport that food back to your local environment. So when we talk about the concept of making healthy choices, in a class like this, where you have access to healthy food, it may seem arbitrary. The reality is that there are millions and millions of Americans who don't have access or the knowledge and know-how to shop healthy. So the consequence of that is the poorest socioeconomic statuses in Canada have higher prevalence of obesity. So if you go to reserves with Native Americans where they don't have access to affordable food, there was an article on CNN not too long ago, not CNN, CBC, where they talked about the price of fresh produce in northern settlements within Canada. A head of cabbage was $11 for a single head of cabbage. So the idea that you can eat healthy when you have access to limited resources becomes a real challenge. And this is everywhere. You can go into major metropolitan cities and map your average household income, plot that on a map, and then overlay that where the inexpensive, unhealthy food choice options are. And guess what? They overlap extremely well. So industry knows that the poorer socioeconomic status, the less educated the people are towards healthy eating. So they make decisions solely based on the financial consequences of that outcome. So it becomes very, very problematic. In Canada, we're starting to see obesity rates skyrocket. And what's sad about that, again, is if you look at, this is 94, we'll look at some more recent stats in a minute. The nice thing about this paper here is it shows that you have about a 20% higher likelihood when you look at Canadians that are not poor, and I forget the exact cutoff they use, but at 15% of the population typically with higher income levels are obese. When we go to children from poor socioeconomic status, that number jumps by 4%. That's significant. And that's significant when you look at how these populations will evolve and how we have to start to think about processed foods, because we need to start to create processed foods that are healthier. In Canada, we've actually, it appears, have turned a corner on the elevating or that increasing rates of obesity. And for about the last 5-10 years, we've started to see a plateau. Unfortunately, that plateau is 30% of the population is obese or overweight. That again translates into billions of healthcare dollars that need to be spent managing the chronic diseases associated with obesity. And this is hugely problematic. So when I started this course, I had found out that I had a fatty liver, and it was because I didn't follow the food guide, nor did I follow well portion control. So when you talk about how to lose weight, there seems to be this trend in North America and in the Western diet for two different things. The first being supplementation of your diet. So we're going to separate out all of the healthy components of foods, and we're going to sell them in bioactive form. So the idea of nutraceuticals, pharmaceuticals, and that's exploded. We've seen so many different bioactives come on the market. Can anyone give me an example of stuff they've seen come on the market that has been sold as the next miracle cure? Vitamin C, a great example. How many people here take a vitamin C supplement? So maybe 15%? What other ones are there? What are the ones that are all in the media right now? Nobody knows any of the miracle cures that are on the market yet. The omega-3s, right? So how many people here take a fish oil pill? So about a tenth of the of the group. What about resveratrol? Or ECGC, why green tea is so good for you? Resveratrol, why red wine is so good for you? polyphenols, why chocolate is so good for you. We find this nuance of science that says that there's a benefit to consuming that product. Industry jumps on it, they extract that product, they throw it in everything, and they try to make foods appear healthier. The other thing that seems to be happening a lot right now are fad diets. So when you talk about weight loss, really popular one is the keto diet. The best way to maintain a healthy diet is to eat less processed food and eat less food. You don't have to restrict one macronutrient over the other. You just have to restrict your calories. So when I went on the Subway diet, yes?
What are your thoughts on the carnivore diet?
Again, so any diet that limits major food groups, so here you're limiting your carbohydrates. Foods that are high in carbohydrates, grains, have a lot of B vitamins associated with them. So when you start talking about selecting a diet, you are going to be devoid in a micronutrient somewhere. There's no one food that will give you a balanced nutritional profile from a micronutrient standpoint. So short term, probably not going to have any major detrimental consequences. Long term, definitely. There was just a story where there was a young woman who had a condition that made her be very selective with her food, and for the last like 15 years, all she ate was chicken McNuggets. She ended up with all kinds of chronic diseases. So again, if you limit your foods, you're gonna develop deficiencies in other places, which is just the reality of it. So the nice thing about, yes?
Sorry, I just have a good example of that.
Sure.
One of my girlfriends, she works with me. She's been doing keto for about 6 or 7 months now, or maybe it's 8, I'm not even sure, but she lost a crap ton of weight. The last time I saw her, she looked really sick. She's very pale, her lips are almost purple, her hair's falling out. She's trying for a kid with her husband and she can't. She's so malnourished.
Right. Which is the reality of it. And we'll talk about the keto diet in 1 minute. So the idea of the Subway diet is that it restricted my calories to about 1,500 calories per day. So about 600 calories less than my average daily need. So I lost 20% about of my body weight, which makes sense because I restricted the calorie. What was even better about that is I lost 20% of my fat, but more importantly, because I have a fatty liver, I saw a reduction in my triglycerides by 25%, so these blood work I just got back yesterday, and I saw a decrease of my HDL-LDL ratio by about 5%, which is huge. Yeah?
So just talk about HDL-LDL. I have eggs like every day for this, right? But my stepmom says that, oh, they're so high in cholesterol, they're
giving
you like CBD.
Right. And again, it's an area of active debate. There's a large population of people who believe, and there's science to support it, that dietary cholesterol doesn't play a major role in circulating cholesterol. So when you talk about your fed or fasted state, it'll elevate your chylomicrons and your LDL in your fed state, but it doesn't translate necessarily to the fasted effects, which is what we typically use as an indicator for health. But there's another population that says, well, we spend the majority of our day in the fasted state, so we should take into account dietary cholesterol. It doesn't seem as prevalent as genetics and overall weight. The one downfall that I was so disappointed with is we still haven't got the microbiome results. I'm gonna tweet it when it comes out. The results, the tests have been sent off, but we just haven't got results yet. But what I wanna talk about today is the idea of being critical. And this is something that I find we don't do enough, and we start to introduce far too late in the education system. So when you evaluate a paper or even a lecture, you should always be wondering where the information came from and what that information means. And what are the consequences of it? And I'm going to give you three examples today that center on health and making those kinds of decisions. So the first one is the Atkins diet. And the Atkins diet is really the keto diet, where you restrict your calories from carbohydrates. Now, why is that beneficial? One is it restricts calories, but the second one is that it relies on the human body using fat for energy. And that metabolism isn't nearly as efficient as it is with glucose. Now, the downfall to the Atkins diet is your primary or your go-to source for energy for the brain is what?
Carbs,
is glucose. If you don't have glucose, your brain has to rely on utilization of ketone bodies. Now, what are ketone bodies? Sorry, we'll come back to this in a second. So I mixed the order of the slides up. So what are ketone bodies? These are ketones and aldehydes that have been, that are a product of lipid oxidation. Now, when you talk about lipid oxidation and lipid utilization, there's a couple things we have to think about. The first is, how is that fat digested? So we know that the fat is digested by breaking off that 1 and 3 position and that 2-monoglyceride gets through. So a ketogenic diet relies on converting those fatty acids into ketones. Those ketones can then be circulated and end up being used as fuel for the brain. Now, there's a new diet that's coming out, and if you're following trends, the keto diet now has a nice modification where you rely on medium chain triglycerides. And this was in response to the fact that saturated fats are not good for you. So if you don't want to eat a lot of saturated fat, and when we talk about saturated fat in the food industry, we're typically talking the long chain fatty acids. So what they did was they increased the amount of medium chain triglycerides. Now, if you remember, from the very first lectures, the big difference between long chain and medium and short chain is their metabolic fate, right? When we talked about the long chain fatty acids, they went into the cells, they were reincorporated, into the epithelial cells, they were reincorporated into triglycerides, packaged with proteins into chylomicrons, and then they went into the lymphatic system where they could be taken up by tissues. Where did short and medium chains go? Does anyone remember? They can, what, short chain can be absorbed by the epithelial cells and utilized there for energy, or they can actually make it into the thoracic duct, right, and go straight to the liver. Why is that good? That's where ketone bodies are produced. So they're produced through the metabolism of fat in the liver, producing the ketone bodies, and then they're allowed to circulate through systemic circulation. But there's problems. Remember when we talked about Maillard reaction, right? And when we talked about lipid oxidation. We talked about aldehydes and ketones being essential in the development of flavors. Anyone else remember what the implications of those were? The big one was inflammation. Inflammation is the precursor to cancer. Inflammation generates free radicals. It does all kinds of biological things that are detrimental. So the downfall to the keto diet is that you produce ketones, ketone bodies, which then are implemented in inflammation. And again, for short periods of times, most people can cope. And most people can cope because they've got a reserve of nutrients that can actually compensate for this restrictive diet. The funny thing, I don't know if I should say funny because someone dying is never funny, but the guy that invented the Atkins diet, they say died of consequences associated with that diet, which is cardiomyopathy. Now, there's all kinds of causes of that. So there's no cause and effect. It's just kind of suiting that he would die of something that could be attributed to diet. So the idea of diet, yes?
I just have a question about if the Atkins diet would have any kind of impact on your glutathione.
So I've never seen anything. Typically, when we look at diets, we look at inflammation markers. So I don't know, is the short answer, yeah. I don't have a good answer for that. It could, yeah, there's definitely that, the possibility. Whether research has been done on it, I'm not sure. It's so far outside of my area. So the idea of diet, I don't think you realize how much that concept has evolved in the last 100 years. So within your grandparents' lifetime, the idea of diet has completely changed. We have moved from the concept of meeting our basic dietary requirements to optimizing health. And this, again, we've talked about again and again in this course, where The optimum diet for individual A may not be the same as the optimal diet for individual B. This could be dependent on your heritage, where you evolved, what diet did you evolve consuming. So if you eat a Western or an Eastern diet, the foods we tend to consume differ. We saw how our genetic profile is based on the foods we consume, high starch versus low starch, AMY1 gene response, copy numbers, right? So the idea of a one-fit solution for everyone is not a good concept for nutrition anymore. We now have the tools, the analytical tools, to move into the idea of nutrigenomics and develop personalized nutrition. So an athlete doesn't require the same micronutrients as someone that's, let's say, an academic. So when we start to think of vitamins and how they play, or any micronutrient, the idea of micronutrients was a concept that was introduced only 120 years ago in the 1900s. And how it came about is actually a fascinating story. And I think it's a story that's worth telling. And it started in the 1900s when the Dutch colonized the West Indies. And what they found was there was this increase in this disease, which was beriberi at the time, and it started to wreak havoc. And they didn't know what caused beriberi. So this professor went over and started to study what changes were happening to create this condition. Now, beriberi was very, very common in West Indies in the poor. And so beriberi, the concept of beriberi, was very, very well understood very early on in the 18 and 1700s, but the exact cause of it was not known. They didn't know which molecule caused that deficiency. So when he went over in a secondment, he went over and did research, and he found that it was related to the foods they were eating. So certain populations had access to rice, while others didn't. And what's really cool about this guy is he also found that microbes die in a logarithmic order. Why is that important? Does anyone remember from the food processing? Really, really important, yeah?
D and Z value.
D and Z value and the consequence of the D value? So you're right 100%. What's the consequence of the D value from a food processing perspective? You can never completely sterilize a food product, right? You can never get to absolute zero. So that's a really, really important contribution to the field of science. He's also the grandfather of vitamins. So he won the Nobel Prize, which was a nice distinction. But what he found when he was studying beriberi was that it was a nutritional disorder characterized by problems with the nerves and the heart. And what he found was, and why he decided it was a nutritional disorder, was he found that breastfeeding mothers, their infants, would all die of sudden cardiac arrest. The reason for it was the compound associated with beriberi was depleted in the mother, so it was depleted in breast milk. Does anyone know what micronutrient causes beriberi? Yeah?
Thiamine.
So he actually won the Nobel Prize for making that link, that a single micronutrient, thiamine, was implemented in the development of beriberi. Now, what was really weird about this was in the 19th century, beriberi started to pop up in populations that hadn't normally seen. So typically, beriberi was seen in the poor, but all of a sudden it started to show up in the wealthier populations, people that were food secure. What happened in the 1900s that would have changed the food supply in the West Indies? Man, my slides are out of order, sorry. It was the introduction of polishing of rice. So polishing of rice corresponded right with this huge increase in beriberi within their population. Why? Because where is B12 micronutrients found in rice? In the bran and in the germ. Why do we eliminate it? Well, when the 1900 hits, there was a huge export market for rice. The problem was Western society didn't really like the appearance of brown rice. They really wanted that highly refined, white polished rice. The other downfall is that the bran contains a lot of lipoxygenase. And lipoxygenase oxidizes fat. Well, if you have to ship, back in the 1900s, rice from Asia to North America or to Europe, it would be on a boat at very elevated temperatures, if it was summer, for quite a long time. So by the time that rice would arrive overseas, that lipid component had oxidized. So they needed to remove that bran layer to produce a shelf-stable product. The problem was that the process became so popular that it became the staple food for the population. So instead of eating whole bran or whole rice, they started to consume a lot more of the polished rice. And the downfall to that was, now all of a sudden they weren't getting enough thiamine. Now what's really interesting with thiamine is, and again, this shows where nutrition has gone in the last 100 years. So in the early 1920s, 30s, everyone was talking about getting enough B12 to prevent beriberi. Where we are today is we are not concerned if anyone in this room has beriberi. But we're all concerned with your B12 levels. Why is that? Because B12 is implemented in things like neural development, in things like Alzheimer's disease and onset of dementia. So now what we're trying to do is we're not worried about whether you get sick today with a nutritional deficiency. We're worried about if you get sick in your 60s and 70s because we want to prolong life expectancy now into the 70s, 80s, and 90s. Yeah?
I was going to say that.
Sorry?
I was going to say that.
Sorry, I always call them the backwards ones, yeah. It's still the same because bran contains both. Sorry. All right. So why did we start milling rice? Again, we did it for the export market to remove lipoxygenase, to ensure that the lipids weren't oxidized, so we could have an export market. This makes sense for so many other things we do in the food industry. Sugar beet, sugar cane, canola, rapeseed, sunflower, safflower, flaxseed. The commodities themselves are very healthy for us. But when we start to take, let's say, flaxseed, something that's extremely healthy, full of micronutrients, we refine it, so we remove all of the natural barriers of that plant to oxidation, right? So that seed coat on a grain of flax is an excellent barrier to oxygen. If you can limit the oxygen that's present or exposed to that lipid, what are you going to slow down? The rate of oxidation. If you slow down the rate of oxidation, you're going to have less free radicals. If you have less free radicals, you're going to have less inflammation. So the idea of moving to highly refined, highly processed foods is counterintuitive to the entire Canadian food guide. So it's kind of a catch-22. We want low-cost, inexpensive, seasonably available foods, but we don't want any depleted nutrient quality. So how do you do that? How do you make a processed food that's not going to undergo nutrient degradation because of heating? So we're not pasteurizing it, we're not sterilizing, we're not canning it, we're not blanching it. And we keep the concentration of micronutrients, we're not refining it, we're not separating it. How do we then introduce barriers that's going to protect those micronutrients? So when we strip that plant, when we break away its natural structure, when we extract the macronutrients and those really refined ingredients, we then have to add back micronutrients. And this doesn't really happen in the food industry. So it's something we need to really start to think about when we look at our processed food industry. And I'll give you a really fun story. So when I was a graduate student here, there was a whole bunch of projects centering on lycopene. Anyone know where lycopene is commonly found? Not mayonnaise. It's in a condiment. Ketchup, tomatoes. It's in really, really high concentrations in tomato skins. Lycopene is an extremely long, conjugated, aliphatic structure. Now, lycopene crystallizes into these beautiful crystals. So in tomatoes, when you eat it, the lycopene is dispersed within that plant tissue. When we process it and extract lycopene, lycopene has a very, very high tendency to crystallize. Now, once lycopene crystallizes, because it's predominantly an aliphatic chain, so kind of like a long chain fatty acid, but without that carboxylic acid group, we have no mechanism to resolubilize it. We have no mechanism to absorb it. So when you talk about lycopene in a tomato, the bioaccessibility, or the amount of that lycopene we can absorb, is extremely high. If we take a supplement, or if we fortify a food with lycopene, those crystals make it almost impossible to absorb. So lycopene that's been extracted from a tomato, refined, crystallized, because they need to sell it as a powder, added back to ketchup, isn't the same as having lycopene from that tomato that's been put into the ketchup. That's just naturally present in the ketchup, sorry. So again, we need to think about how and why we're processing foods. So in the 1900s, the first, did you have a question?
Yeah, I was just wondering, why is it extracted?
Well, because I can't, so it, the idea of marketing a tomato to be healthy doesn't have nearly the same markup associated with being able to market a processed food. So I can put a larger markup on it. There's more of an industrialization. There's more profit to be made. There, when you talk about horticultural advertising, go eat your lettuce. When do you see commercials like that? We never do, right? Like, bananas are healthy. Tomatoes are healthy. Lettuce is healthy. We don't see advertisements for that, but we see advertisements all the time for cereals fortified with folic acid are better for you. So it's that whole concept of the industrialization and the cost recovery associated with it. So again, in the 1900s, they started to, well, they first identified that B12 has that beneficial association with health. So what they began to do is figure out how much do we need to prevent disease in 95% of the population. So 5% of the population, the RDA, the recommended dietary intake or allowance, doesn't meet your needs. So right away, we're already subjecting 5% of the population to deficiencies based on these numbers. This again brings us back to the concept of personalized nutrition. Every one of us, our dietary needs are different based on the diet we consume, but also on our biological makeup and what we're trying to do. This is a slide directly taken from Dr. Spinola or Paul's work when he gave his guest talk. And he talked about regulating health claims. One of the things I noticed in 3090 was everyone had these really neat health claims that they were talking about on their food product. And this happened in the 1970s. In the 1970s, all of a sudden, this whole case with beriberi hit the news waves. It was on front page news that a single molecule in food could prevent disease. And the world exploded with people being health conscious towards vitamins and minerals and micronutrients. And all of a sudden, there was this mass pandemonium. So beer, drink it outside and you're going to have the sunshine vitamin D associated with it because you're going to drink it outside on the beach. You can, instead of eating a healthy, balanced diet, you can eat a vitamin donut. And my favorite, Baby Ruth enriched with dextrose. So all of a sudden, language started to be used in advertising that would make things that were not nutritionally beneficial in any sort of fashion seem like there was a benefit to having it. All of a sudden, when something's enriched with dextrose, you have the feeling that you need dextrose in your diet. So this all came about, and all of a sudden, government had to regulate. So one thing Paul didn't talk about when he talked about the health claims associated with the food industry is there's only about 13 claims, either reduction claims, things like low in sodium, low in sugar, low in fat, and health claims. There's about 5 or 6 beneficial for heart disease. One of the reasons is the evidence has to be absolutely overwhelming that cause and effect is in place. So we can't just look at the Greenland Inuit, compare them to Greenland individuals living in Denmark, and say polyunsaturated fats and oils are good for us. But not only that, once that evidence is there, we then make sure that that food is healthy. So we restrict the amount. First we say there has to be a very minimum of that nutrient. So if we're making a plant sterile, how much sterile actually has to be present in that plan. Not only does it matter how much sterol is in it, it matters what the serving size is. So are we going to eat enough of it to actually have a biological effect? Also, there's typically limitations on the amount of sugar, the amount of salt, and the amount of cholesterol that's in that food. So even though we may have sufficient plant sterols, if we have too much sugar, we can't make that health claim. So all health claims have this huge criteria of other conditions that must be met. So psyllium fiber, soluble fiber, oats, Metamucil, they can make those health claims. But again, go into your grocery store, walk around the perimeter of that grocery store, and check how few health claims are actually associated with products. The only two areas, so I did this last weekend, the only two areas that were really, really high in health claims was the cereal aisle and the dairy area, like the yogurt, the cheese, sour cream, things like that. So the idea of health claims are highly restricted for very good reason, because we don't want that misleading advertising saying that this product is going to give a health benefit when in reality, overall, it doesn't provide any nutritional benefit. So when you start to go into the field and you go into the food industry or you become a dietitian or a nutritionist, every time you hear something about food, there's some things you should think about. The first is, what concentration is there in foods that I naturally consume and why is it needed? So is the concentration that's in your diet sufficient? Are the compounds being sold that are functionally active? Really good example of this is B12. So B12 has four different forms. There's adenocobalamin, methylcobalamin, adenosyl, and I forget the fourth one. But those three, the biological efficiency of them, differ. So again, where were these observations first made? In organ meats. So organ meats have very, very high levels of B12. How many of you eat liver? Really? Oh, wow. Good for you. How many of you eat oysters? So those are your great sources of B12. How many people here are a strict vegetarian, eat no animal products? How many of you take a B12 supplement? One. So anyone here that's a vegetarian that doesn't take a B12 supplement? One. So there is no B12 in produce. You only get B12 from animal sources. Now, the people that take a supplement, how many of you take an over-the-counter supplement of B12? One, two. Anyone take a different source of B12? No? So the conversion of B12 from an over-the-counter product is less than 25%. It is unbiologically accessible. It's a compound that has to be converted through many, many steps in the body to become biologically active. Why do they sell the cobalamin mainly as a bioactive? Because it's shelf stable. You can't extract it from organ meat and put it into foods because it breaks down too quickly. So when you go, if you are a vegetarian, you should actually go to your doctor and get injections of B12. That's the only way to get sufficient B12 if you're a true vegetarian. Again, no animal products, no cheese, no butter. If you restrict your diet to have no animal product, you need to be supplementing with B12 injections. Yeah?
What are the other sources of B12
in? It's in all animal products. It's concentrated in organ meats. But it's found in dairy. It's found everywhere in animal products. It's common. Yeah? It's not that they don't do anything, it's that their biological efficiency is far lower than if you take the organ meat or the injection. So you do get a biological benefit, but you have to take much, much more of it. Yeah. So if you look at like Kirkland multivitamins or Centrum, they all use the cobalamin, which has the much lower biological availability. Yeah. So are the health benefits ubiquitous? Does everybody need that micronutrient? And we're going to talk about this one because this makes me so angry of our Canadian food industry. Is the compound biologically available? This is happening right now in the cannabis industry. Everyone wants to make a product that you can consume or eat THC and get the biological effects of it. The problem is THC is only about 6% bioavailability when consumed. So if you eat edibles, you have to consume far more marijuana dry basis than you would if you inhaled it, because it's not as biologically accessible. The industry is already starting to look at co-surfactants to try to increase it. Do I get enough in my diet? And this is one that you see all the time, where you see this new fad molecule pop up, and there's really no need to actually start supplementing it. And then remember, irrespective of what that nutrient is, there is always a point at which there is too much. And this goes from everything to water, to sugar, to proteins. Everything has a too much side. So I'm going to talk about two different bioactives that have been on the market and that have been talked about a lot. The first one was my old pet peeve. And this was the idea that, again, the French have a far lower incidence of heart disease than North Americans, although they eat a diet that's much greater in saturated fat than us. And what they say, and what the argument was again in the 80s and 90s, was that because they drank so much alcohol, that there was a benefit. So then people started to say, well, what's the benefit from alcohol? We know ethanol is toxic for us at high concentrations, but what about resveratrol? So everyone started to say that this antioxidant was the new super compound. And it was higher in red wine than in white wine. So everyone was starting to say, oh, I'm drinking red wine for resveratrol. Has anyone ever heard about resveratrol in red wine? So a few. So again, the idea was, and they showed in rat models and in cell line work, that resveratrol had a lot of really important benefits. They saw, like most antioxidants, there was an anti-inflammatory effect, which is great when you start talking about preventing cancers. And it also had a blood sugar lowering effect. So great, this is all good news, right? Resveratrol is a compound that's good for us. Now, whether or not it influences us to drink more or not, well, we'll see. So this compound, this formulation, is just a resveratrol supplement. And what they found was to get the same level of resveratrol in our body as was introduced into the mice, we had to consume between 3 and 5 grams of resveratrol a day. How many bottles of wine would you have to drink to get that much resveratrol? Let's take some guesses.
20.
2,000. 20. 30. 4. Anything over 2 glasses for a female and 4 glasses for a male, or 3 glasses for a male, is too much. So between 500 and 1,000 bottles of red wine a day to get the same biological effect shown in that study. So any benefit that you get from resveratrol is going to be very quickly superseded by the detrimental effects associated with alcohol. So you have to begin to become critical of the research that's beginning to come into literature. And this is something that is very, very difficult to do. Because a lot of times there are gaps in research articles, and you have to fill in those gaps. But that's part of being here. And that's part of what you guys and girls, guys, I think I say that because I call my little boys guys. You need to become extremely critical of the information that you're presented. What I'm teaching you will be outdated, and there'll be parts of it that are wrong in 10 years because the science changes. So you need to be critical. So what is the concentration and required and why? Well, yes. There are. You can buy it. Yep. Your best source of it is red grapes. It's in the seed skin and raisins. Those are the if you want resveratrol, I wouldn't buy a supplement. I would eat grapes. Yeah. I won't say it. I think you know what I was going to say. So this one. This makes me angry. But it's such a good story and it gives such a great lesson. So folate. Folate is extremely important. Why do we need folate in our diet? What does it prevent? Neural tube defects. Last time I checked, I wasn't going to bear a child anytime soon. So my folate requirements are much, much different than a child-bearing female, right? A child-bearing age female. So, folate is extremely important in preventing neural tube defects. We do not fortify any foods with folate. It's too expensive, too unstable. So what do we produce? Very, very inexpensive and very easy to convert, to produce folic acid. And folic acid can be converted in the body to tetrahydrofolate. This compound is what prevents neural tube defects. Folate and folic acid do not. Okay? Now, all breakfast cereals in Canada are supplemented with folic acid, right? We know that. Folic acid is extremely beneficial at preventing birth defects. The science that proves that, there is no question that it prevents neural tube defects. And you can even see that we've cut the amount of birth defects, this is back in 2002, associated with the fortification of folic acid. And one of the reasons is folic acid is extremely important when we undergo periods of rapid cell division. When do we not want to undergo periods of rapid cell division? When you have cancers, when you have early edema, so early cell early edemas are early tumors that develop that are the first stages. So what they did in this study here, and I don't understand why we supplement folic acid in breakfast cereals because of this, but what they did is they took about 900 men and they broke them into three groups. The first group was, you're not going to get any folic acid supplement. You're just going to take an aspirin a day. That's all you get. The second group got folic acid and no aspirin. The third group got folic acid and aspirin. So they had to make sure that the effects they were observing weren't because of a daily aspirin. So we had three groups, one consuming folic acid, one consuming folic acid and aspirin, one consuming only aspirin. And do you know what they found? The population of men over the 10-year study that had developed prostate cancers was 9.7% in the group that was consuming folic acid, compared to 3.3% in the group that was taking the placebo and aspirin. So men that are not planning on getting pregnant, which I would assume is most of us, where is the biological need for folic acid? We don't have the same requirement. Now, what else this study did, which was really interesting, was they showed that folate levels in circulation had no correlation with prostate cancer. So men could eat all the broccoli, all the cauliflower, all the natural sources of folate they wanted, and they had no increased risk of cancer. But when they took the folic acid, remember, folic acid enters that metabolic pathway in a different spot. When they took folic acid, they saw a threefold increase in the onset, in the prevalence of prostate cancers. And what's mind-boggling about this is if you go buy an over 50 senior men's supplement, they supplement it with folic acid, which makes no sense at all. So again, when we start to talk about the idea of nutraceuticals, always, always be skeptical about, one, is what we're fortifying it with the same thing that was in that natural diet. So again, let's go back to the Greenland Inuit. The Greenland Inuit eat a diet that's enriched in marine source animal fats. Enriched omega-3s and 6 found in things like seal blubber, whale blubber, cold water fish like salmon. These foods are eaten in a traditional way. Typically, they're not highly refined, right? They're slaughtered and then consumed. They're not stored, they're not deep fried, they're not battered. So the idea that we buy salmon that's a week old before we even get it, so right when we kill that fish, we kill its biological mechanisms that protect that fat, right? So all of the natural barriers that are protecting that omega-3 and that omega-6 from oxidation. Remember, omega-3s, omega-6s undergo oxidations hundreds of times faster than saturated and monounsaturated. So now we've stored them for a week. We try to freeze them. We try to slow down the rate. But then as a consumer, we cook them, and we cook them with extremely temperature abusive methods. We cook them at high temperatures. We barbecue them. Worst of all, we deep fry them. When you begin to do that, you begin to introduce new compounds that weren't originally part of that food. We begin to change the biological makeup of those molecules. We get cis-trans isomerization during oxidation. We get the formation of free radicals. We get the formation of aldehydes, ketones, carboxylic acids, short-chain alkanes. All of these change the composition of that food. So to say that because Greenland Inuit ate fresh, cold water fish doesn't mean we should eat deep fried cold water fish, which we see all the time in the North American diet. So again, when there's studies that say folic acid is good, and all of us, sorry, folate is good, and then all of a sudden they're supplementing with folic acid, we have to be critical enough to say, is there a difference? And now with this whole concept of personalized nutrition, we need to start realizing that how we supplement for individual A should not be the same as how we supplement for individual B. So again, in this study, what they found wasn't the amount of folate in the blood that was causing the problem. And again, they showed that dietary folate had no association with prostate cancer. It was, you have a question up there? Probably because they were prostate cancer researchers. Probably no good reason. This would be applicable to all solid tumors. It would probably be applicable to all cancers, with the exception maybe of blood cancers. But we'll talk about something that kind of relates to that in a second. Yeah?
So folic acid beneficial in any aspect
for those? Well, you need a, so be careful with that. So again, folic acid and folate are different. Folate has all kinds of beneficial effects. So men should eat foods rich in folate. Men should not eat foods enriched in folic acid. It's again that whole concept of, let's make a breakfast cereal, sugar puffs. Let's throw in a whole bunch of sugar. Let's throw in a whole bunch of refined carbohydrates. Let's make a really unhealthy product and then throw a supplement in it. Makes no sense. Like, there's just no logic behind that industrialization of our foods. Yeah? Huge problem. Not only from a supplement perspective, but from a food industry perspective. So measuring oxidation is extremely difficult. The reason it's extremely difficult is that the products that are formed vary, right? So remember when we talked about that free radical forming, we get the shifting of those conjugations. That shifting leads to different peroxides being formed. The different peroxides form different beta scission. That leads to different aldehydes and ketones. So to measure oxidation of an end product becomes very difficult because there's so many different end products depending on where that lipid broke down. So not only is it hard from a consumer perspective, even as an ingredient company, it's extremely hard to know if you're, like, again, when we talk about measuring oxidation, most of the profiles look like this. So if you know the history, and this is the whole concept of blockchain technologies, if we can track using blockchain the level of oxidation at each step, we can know exactly where we are. But you could end up having two values identical, one being, let's say, 10% oxidized, the other being 90% oxidized, and you get the exact same value. You need to know the history of that product. So even taking products off the shelf and measuring them, it's hard to know whether or not that's oxidized or not. So it depends when you go to that grocery store or wherever you're buying your product, how is it stored? What kind of container is it in? Is it exposed to UV light? Has it been exposed to oxygen, depending on the type of product? Now, there are other things that companies do. They'll create capsules that are barriers to oxygen themselves. The problem isn't typically when you buy the product. It's after you've opened that seal, oxidation accelerates, because now you've exposed that environment to oxygen. It's not that it hasn't happened. It's that the acceleration happens after the consumer. Really good example was fortification of EPA and DHA in milk. Again, they found that EPA and DHA didn't significantly change until you open that carton. The second you open that carton, you could start to measure trace amounts of trans fats being formed that were not transvicinic or CLA, that were being introduced because of the oxidation of that fat of the omegas. So it really depends. It depends partially on how the manufacturer does it, but it also depends significantly on how the consumer treats their product as well. So, again, not saying folate is detrimental. I'm saying what we use as a substitute, and again, we do this all the time. We do it with B12. We do it with almost all micronutrients, because a lot of the micronutrients that are present in food are not stable. And we've talked about this. We've talked about it from a thermal perspective, from an oxygen exposure perspective. So we need to develop new techniques that are less harmful to the food micronutrients. Yeah?
Sorry, could you elaborate on the difference between folate and folate?
So I don't know too much. I don't think they know why exactly. I know that. So tetrahydroxyfolate is a cyclic process. And when you have folic acid and folate, they enter at different points, so the metabolomics of it are quite different when you look at the full pathway. So whether it's an upregulation of an enzyme or a byproduct of something that's kicked off the molecule, we don't know. Yeah. Now, here is the craziest thing I've ever learned in food science. And I always find it so funny. So, all early chemotherapeutics, all of them, all of the methotrexate, all of those early chemotherapeutics relied on inhibiting folic acid metabolism. Why? Because when you're treating cancer, you want to slow down the rate of cell division. So the worst thing you could possibly do, if you're on one of these treatments, is to eat breakfast cereals fortified with folic acid. So when we start to look at our food supply, we need to take a step back from the industrialization of our foods, and we need to think, what are the consequences of not only the food industry, but also the nutraceutical industry, the functional food industries? We should always be asking these questions. Because where we are going now are foods that are very shelf stable, that are ultra processed, that are inexpensive, that are devoid in fiber, that are devoid in micronutrients, that are enriched in simple sugars, high in salt, high in cholesterol, high in trans fats. And we need to begin to reverse that. We need to begin to reverse it on the company side, not on the consumer side. So we can only educate so many consumers. And the problem is, messaging around nutrition, we have done an atrocious job at. If you watch CNN for a week, you will see stories saying that compound A is great for us. Compound A is bad for us. So we switch back and forth. We've seen it in the last 20 years with saturated fats associated with dairy products. They're back in style. So if you're 60 years old and you were in your 40s and they were telling you, avoid dairy products, and now they're saying, fortify your diet with dairy products, what do you do? And again, this is a systemic problem in the food industry. We really, really need to begin to rethink how we process our foods and how we treat our global food supply. Because again, overprocessing and ultra-processing foods does not meet the requirement for nutritious, safe food. food supply. So with that, this is, okay, why, just give me a, okay, okay, that's there.
We sent one of our pals, Chris McGaha, to a rally to collect signatures for a petition. She's going to ask people to sign a petition banning dihydrogen monoxide. That's dihydrogen monoxide. Water. That's right, water. And she's not going to lie or even stretch the truth. Not at all. She's just going to talk about what water is and what it does with the vocabulary and tone of environmental hysteria.
This is a petition for dihydrogen monoxide. What it is it's a chemical that is found now in reservoirs and in lakes. Pesticides, different kind of companies are using this. It's styrofoam companies, nuclear companies. And now when they use it in pesticides, when we're washing our fruit and things like that, it's not coming out. Which of course means that it's ended up in the grocery stores and in our baby's food and stuff like that. Causes excessive sweating, excessive urination, anything to help the environment.
These people signed. We don't know if they thought, but they signed.
There we are.
Can I get you guys to sign a petition?
What for?
For banning dihydrogen monoxide?
Oh, yeah, I'll sign that.
Thank you very much.
And our petition woman was getting signatures left and right. Oh, okay, mostly left. But man, there's a lot of people against that evil water.
It's everywhere, and we just really need to ban it. Two more supporters.
These passionate, informed people didn't even need to ask what dihydrogen monoxide is. They didn't even ask. Is passion supposed to replace common sense? We understand the desire to join up and do something important. It's sexy to save the world, but you gotta spend a couple of minutes to find out if you're really saving the world and not just being herded around by some politically motivated assholes who may not really care that much about the environment, but see this as some chance to raise money for whatever they think is a good idea. No end justifies the means of lying. Man, there were a lot of people who signed the petition. And we're not talking a handful of dopes. We're talking hundreds.
It causes a lot of urination, vomiting.
Yeah, I'm
can
familiar
even cause...
with it.
Oh, okay.
Even the head organizer of this rally signed the petition eagerly.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Hi, will you sign my petition?
And our petition was still getting signatures.
Thank you very much. Companies like pesticide companies, styrofoam companies, nuclear companies, all of these people use it.
Finally, we let her tip it.
Are you concerned about water?
I am, yeah.
Is water something that should be banned?
What sort of water?
Water.
Should be banned?
Yes.
No, I don't think so. I think we need to drink water, and I don't know what you mean by water should be banned.
This petition is to ban water. Dihydrogen monoxide is water. H2O.
No.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, we set these folks up, but it does show that maybe they're not so much environmentalists as they are joiners of anything.
So just remember that when you guys go into industry and start providing advice to people based on what they should be eating, always keep that in the back of your mind, because it's something that's it's humorous, but it really highlights the need to be informed, and to be informed at the most basic science level. So when you start to hear about nutraceuticals being so good for you, go and see what the literature says, because there is a lot of bad, bad contradicting science that exists, and you are going to have to become experts in it. So all those papers that were embedded in all these documents, read them. Look for the mistakes. Look for where it can be improved, because you will be the leaders that make these decisions for everyone. Not just yourselves, but again, you're going to be making these decisions for companies that are going to make decisions on where their product line is going to go. And we need to have people that have a social conscience that decides on how foods are structured. There is nothing more important, nothing in society that's more important than food. There was just a heartbreaking story on CNN last week where a mother in a refugee camp had to sell her daughter because they didn't have access to food. Imagine being put in those choices. We are extremely fortunate to have a safe food supply. We are not ethically responsible with our food supply, and that needs to change. So again, I hope that some of this course resonated with you, and that if you take anything with this course, that's what it is that we need a social conscience when we talk about our food supply. Next, on Thursday coming, we're gonna have a really fun spin on the food chemistry stuff. Please, please be here. Please be sure to tell everyone to come. Again, we've got something kind of fun planned. See you Thursday.